Well, I've never seen this many people in the garden before. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Stephen. I know why you're looking at me like that. I look like Jesus, don't I? I've had that happen one or two times before, but no, I'm actually the gardener here in this garden outside of Jerusalem. But can I tell you about a story one time with Jesus when I got... Somebody thought that I was Jesus when I got interpreted as being Jesus? Can I tell you about that story? You might know some of the characters in Mary Magdalene that morning that Jesus died, came to the tomb early Sunday morning. It was dark. Trust me, I wasn't there yet. I hadn't had my coffee, so I wasn't in the garden yet working that day. It was way too early for me to be there. But Mary came in, told me this story later, but she came in and she was getting ready to come to the grave just to be there, to weep and to mourn the loss of her Savior. She came empty-handed because Nicodemus, on the Friday that they took him off the cross, brought in hundreds of pounds of spices to prepare the man for death, for his burial. And she came running into the garden that morning and looked and saw the big brown stone that was in front of the door rolled away. And it was a nice tomb. Trust me, I know. I've been helping get it prepared for Joseph of Arimathea, the rich man that owned it. And it had a nice round stone for the door, and not many people could afford that kind of a tomb. It was something very special, something that man gave up for somebody that he thought was very special. And she came in and she saw that big stone had been rolled away, and she assumed that somebody came in and stole his body, because that was rampant. I don't know why people would go into other people's tombs and take their bodies, but it happened. They do it all the time nowadays. So she ran back, and she got Peter and John. Peter and John came running back into the garden again. I still wasn't there. Mary told all this to me later that afternoon after it all happened. But Peter and John come running back, and they run into the tomb. And they see laying there where his body had been laying, they see the linen wrappings, right, that they wrap his body in. And Peter then notices the shroud that they put on his face, folded up neatly and laying in a completely different spot. That, my friends, is the first clue that somebody didn't steal his body. Because if they wanted to take the body, they would have just taken it, not taken the time to take all the linen off. Plus, the linen's worth money. They found the cloth laying there, and they looked at it. And then they left. Like they didn't know what to do. He's not here. What do we do? They didn't even stay to look for him. They just ran in and saw that he was gone. And they went home. But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping because she wanted to mourn the loss of her teacher. She wanted to mourn the loss of this person who she'd walked with for 3 years of her life and learned so much from. She wanted to be there to mourn his passing and his loss. And as she's weeping and she's looking into the tomb, she sees two angels who ask her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" "I'm sorry, that's just a really stupid question. Why is she crying? For someone she loves has just died. Why do you ask someone that question?" She stood there weeping, not understanding, because her Lord was missing, her teacher was gone. And she turned around in her grief, and she saw someone standing there, and she thought it was me. I like it when people confuse me for Jesus. Although I know I don't look like him, I wish I could act like him a little bit more often. But she thought that the gardener was there, and the gardener, the person that she saw in her grief and her strickenness, and her weeping, and she looked at him, and he said, "Woman, how are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" She couldn't tell that it was him. She was so struck with grief, and she wasn't expecting him to be alive. And then he looked at her. He looked at her, and he said, "Mary." She fell to her feet, and she looked at him and said, "Rabboni," which of course means teacher. But when Mary told me the story later that afternoon, and the way that she said it, and the brightness of her eyes, and the sound of her voice, it meant, "Oh, my beloved teacher, I'm so glad to see you. I can't believe that you're here for us again." You see, he said her name. He wasn't just somebody else. Jesus called her by name. by the name that he used so many times over the years that they walked and she learned from him, and the things that he taught her. And he called her and loved her. He knew who she was. Now you see, I didn't know Jesus personally when he was alive. I knew who he was. He was that rebel rouser that came into town last week with all those people coming behind him, thinking he was some highfalutin thing riding into town on a donkey. He thought he was all that. You know, he comes into town, he causes all this trouble, he stirs up all these problems, and then lo and behold, the Romans said they can take care of it. Right? They hang him on a cross. But Mary explained to me later that afternoon after she went to the tomb and found it empty about how it was all supposed to happen, about how he'd been talking about this for years. So all the time that they've been together, he talked about how he was going to have to go to Jerusalem and die, and they never got it. They never understood it. They never understood the fact that he was going to be the sacrifice for them, to give them a place with God, to help them, to have the relationship that Jesus wanted them to have with his Father, like he had. He was going to be the one that would take that place for all of us. He was the one that went to that cross for me. He went there for you. He did it because he loves us. See, I didn't know that. But when Mary told me the story about how he was there, and the love that I heard in her eyes, and the brightness in her face, and the way that her voice sounded about how when she spoke about this man who had given everything for all of us, I believed it. Because he not only died for Mary, he died for me, he died for you. And he rose up from that tomb, not just for Mary, but for me and for you. And if we listen, just like Mary, we will hear the old sweet sound of our name come rolling off the lips of our Savior as he calls each and every one of us to come behind him and follow him into the life that he has prepared for us. The life that we can have together in a relationship with our Father. We just but listen. Trust me, you'll hear the sweet sound of your name and we'll offer it.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.